Hello, good morning students. Today I'll explain you regarding aerial adaptations or volant adaptations. Aerial adaptations are those adaptations which any animal shows to remain in the air. Adaptations basically, they are very important for the survival of the organism as the environment is ever changing. Without adaptations, no individual can survive. So, real adaptations, basically, they are of two types. Number one, primary aerial adaptations. Number two, secondary aerial adaptations. Primary aerial adaptations, they are shown by the birds. Whereas the secondary aerial adaptations, they are shown by the fishes, amphibians, reptiles and mammals. Coming to primary aerial adaptations, to overcome the air resistance, the bodies of bird are streamlined. The skeleton of bird is hollow to reduce the weight. Their bones, they are pneumatic and they are filled with air to support flight. Many bones, like the bony tail of early bird, which were not necessary, are lost over the period of evolution. Tooth jaw of early birds have been replaced with lightweight beak. The feathers of the birds have hooklets known as barbules at the veins that zip the veins of individual feather together. This gives the feather the strength that needs to hold the airfall. This is usually absent in flightless birds. The barbules of the feather are to maintain the shape and the function of the feather. Then there is a reduction of the internal organs is there to reduce the weight, that is ovary and oviduct of right side is absent and the urinary bladder is absent in the case of the birds. Presence of air sacs is there, which makes the body light. These incinerate processes, they are helpful for the birds to fly. So they are responsible for making a basket where the organs, they are placed properly during the flight. The pectoral girdle as well as the pelvic girdle, they are quite stout. And another important thing is the air sacs. So we have got large number of air sacs where air is filled, like clavicle air sac, anterior thoracic air sac, posterior thoracic air sac, as well as the abdominal air sac. Air sacs, here the air is present, making the individual light, plus they will provide additional sort of respiration to the bird during flight. Now coming to the secondary aerial adaptation, first example is the Exocetus, the flying fish. The pectoral fins are enlarged to form gliding surface and the ventral lobe of the caudal fin is elongated to make dashes on water surface to push the animal for the gliding flight. The flying fish has unevenly forked tail, which has a top lobe that is shorter than the bottom lobe. Upper lobe is shorter, lower lobe is larger. The fish propel themselves out of the water at a speed of more than 55 kilometers per hour. Once in air, their rigid wings allow them to glide for up to 200 meters. Flying fish evolved a flying mechanism to escape from many oceanic predators. The wing-like pectoral fins are primarily for gliding. The fish holds the fin flat at their sides when swimming. Their streamlined body reduces drag when the fish are flying. Next example of secondary aerial adaptation is of tree frog belonging to class Amphibia, that is Rhacophorus. It is the only amphibian in which volant adaptations they are found. It has webbed feet by which it has long prolonged leaps. Rudiments of patagia in front and behind the arms are also present. These provide an increase in the surface area so that when the limbs, fingers and toes are extended apart, they allow the frog to glide from high perches. This species has ability to glide up to 50 feet. Flying frog is an arboreal amphibian that has a terminal segment of each finger and toe which is expanded into specialized adhesive pads that allows these tree frog to adhere to the vertical surface. Next example, it belongs to the class Reptilia, that is the Draco. Here in the Draco lizard, wings extend from just behind the front legs to just in front of the back legs. The last 5 to 7 of the lizard ribs are elongated and extend into the wings. The muscle attached to the ribs cause the ribs to move and wings to unfurl like an opening fan when the animal wants to glide. The wings are also known as patagia. Draco lizards can move their patagia as they glide as well as their tail, which acts like a rudder for steering. They have flattened appearance while gliding. Draco lizards can glide as far as 60 meters. So here, what is extended? Ribs, they are extended. 5 to 7 of the ribs, they are extended. Next adaptation is shown by the mammal, that is bat. In bat, humerus is well developed, radius is long, and ulna is vestigial. The pollex is free and cloved. Second finger is distinct but not free from third and is attached distally to support the anterior margin of the wing. Fourth and fifth digits are well developed. Bird's wing membrane is known as patagium and is supported by arm and by four highly elongated fingers. Hence, it is named as chiroptera, that is hand wing. The patagium extends all the way around the bat's hind leg and tail, where it forms a flap called uropatagium, supported by specialized foot bones called calcare. Not only does the uropatagium helps the bat to fly, it is often used to sweep prey such as insects on the wings into bat's mouth while the bat is in flight. Next adaptation is shown by the flying lemurs, that is Galeoptera. Cannot actually fly, it has a flap of skin called patagium between the arms. When they spread this out, it catches the air and allows them to glide long distances without losing much height. This helps the lemur move between the treetops. In addition of being used for gliding, female lemur can hold their patagium into a pouch for their babies to ride in. The pouch protects the infants and keep them warm. This adaptation allows the babies to move with the mother even as she glides between the tree. Their feet are sticky like small suction cups. This adaptation helps them as they climb tree and keep them from falling when they land after the wing. Next is the adaptation shown by the insects. As you know, insect wings are made up of cuticle strengthened by thickened veins. Typically, there are two pairs of wings developed on dorsolateral sides of meso and metathoracic segments. In Diptera, only mesothoracic wings they are developed. So these are some of the examples showing the aerial adaptation, both primary and secondary, right from the fishes to the mammal. So I hope the concept is clear. Thank you.